A wiser feller than myself once said, sometimes you eat the turd sandwich, sometimes the turd sandwich, well, it eats you.
We were talking about Furiosa just a second ago. My heading name is just a stupid joke. I did not think it was boring, but there have been people who have said that it's not Mad Max Fury Road. It doesn't have the pacing of Fury Road.
It's You're a right. little bit slower. Mad Max Fury Road. It's a different movie in the same franchise.
Yeah, yeah. But like, yeah, people compare it to Fury Road, which you should. I think that's okay. But yeah, people are just complaining about the pacing. It's like, it's not bad. It's not Fury Road. I'll go ahead and get that out of the way. Is like, did I enjoy this as much as Fury Road? Heck no. Like, Fury Road's like a masterpiece when it comes to action movies.
Yeah.
Like, that's just how that is. But this movie was good. It was a good time. When it comes to the ratings and reviews of getting it like a 9 out of 10 and stuff, I don't know about that. But it is good though. It's a good movie.
Yeah.
But yeah, you were talking about a second ago about how a lot of people are basing quality of a film off of the box office.
Yeah, I saw someone make a comment on a post about Furiosa mentioning that, like, you know, the box office is basically a measure of its quality, pretty much. I don't remember exactly what they were saying. They were like, everybody thought this movie was going to be great, but look at the box office. And it's like, shut up. You're an idiot.
Yeah, like judging stuff off of box office is very, very stupid. Because there's a ton of amazing movies that didn't make amazing box office.
Yeah.
This one, I am surprised that it's not doing better, but it's just one of those things. But yeah, there's amazing movies that like this one's easily going to break 100 million, probably 200 million. I don't know if it's going to hit 300 million, but like, yeah, there's a good bit of amazing movies that never break 100 million.
Yeah.
And it's like, I don't judge the quality of the movie. Cause if I remember right, I think The Northman didn't make amazing box office.
It would surprise me if it did.
Yeah. I want to say it made less than 100 million, but let me check. Yeah. It made less than 100 million. So it's like that. And that's a fantastic movie. And then I'm not bashing this movie, but I don't think it's like great or amazing. Then you have the other side where not all movies that make $1.5 billion or $2 billion are great. The case in point from last year, you had Super Mario Bros. Like, it's a fine movie. I don't think it's a bad movie.
Yeah.
It, in my opinion, in terms of like, does it deserve that type of money or whatever? No, but it's very marketable because it's very kid friendly and stuff. Like, everyone knows Mario, so obviously it's going to make a lot of money. But if you're basing quality off of the money, like, you can't do that, because like Super Mario just from last year is a fine movie. It's not good. It's not great. It's not bad either. It's just, yeah, that was a decent watch.
Yeah. I'll allow it.
Yeah, yeah.
Mario, you can stay.
And then occasionally you do get a movie that makes over $1 billion and is really good. Doesn't happen a lot. Like there are a good bit of movies that make over $1 billion and are good. I'd say a lot of Marvel movies are that way. They're good.
Yeah.
I'm not going to say all of them that make over $1 billion are really good or great.
Oh, no.
But I mean, like Barbie last year, I thought that was a really good movie. I really liked Barbie. So with it making so much money, yeah, that's cool.
I've only seen the Enheimer part of Barbenheimer.
The which part?
The I've only seen Oppenheimer between the two movies. Oppenheimer. So I'm really wondering if any additional context is provided to that movie if I see Barbie. I'm wondering if like there are some plot details that might be clarified. I don't even understand why America was at war to begin with. So maybe Barbie will clear that up.
Well, Barbie's a sequel to Oppenheimer.
Oh, Barbie's the sequel?
It's the sequel to Oppenheimer, and it just shows how we became united. Like the fear was at the end of Oppenheimer that, oh no, things are going to get really bad because of nuclear war being introduced. But then Mattel made Barbie, and that corrected everything.
Okay. Dang, I wonder where to go. I wonder where I'm supposed to go to see a movie that explains what was up with that World War thing that was going on.
Because, yeah, I can only learn through movies.
Exactly. And I'm not talking about documentaries, people.
No.
Those are boring. I'm talking about cinema.
Yeah, I want beautiful cinematography and drama added. And all of the dramatic stuff is history. That all did happen.
Yeah. How else would I know what it was like to be an Italian-American mafioso in the 80s if not for Martin Scorsese?
Yes.
How would I know how easy it actually was to beat up Bruce Lee if it wasn't for the fact that that movie was Quentin and Tarantined by written directino?
Yeah. And also, I learned through that movie that Sharon Tate is still around today.
Yeah.
Because of that.
Yeah.
She doesn't act much anymore. I don't know.
Yeah, I'm not sure what happened.
Yeah.
But those Mansons were crazy.
Yeah, yeah. Good thing Brad Pitt and Leonardo DiCaprio stopped them.
Yeah. Brad Pitt and Leonardo the Capricorn.
Yeah, but Furiosa was good. I don't think it was a bore. It is different pace than Fury Road.
Yeah.
Like I said before, Fury Road is going to go down as one of the best action movies ever. Whether you like the movie or not, just based on all that it did, yeah. You kind of have to go yeah, I could see that. Me personally, I love Fury Road. But this one was good. It was good. It's definitely worth the watch. I saw it in IMAX. I'm glad I did that. But now I'm just waiting for next year for that 10th anniversary of Fury Road so I can just watch that in theater.
Yeah.
So hopefully they do that. If they don't, I'm going to find you, George Miller, even though George Miller would have nothing to do with that. That's the studios. But I'm going to find George Miller and be like, why didn't you press them harder to do a 10th anniversary theatrical release?
Yeah.
George. He's going to be like, oi, I was too busy grilling up shrimp on the barbie.
I was in the desert. Too busy getting my baby from the dingo. I was busy burrowing underground looking for grubs. And eating them up like a badger. Eating grubs up like a badger. We don't have badgers in Australia. We are wombats and quokkas. Down here in the outback. He just runs around naked. That's how he is at every shoot. He personally carries the camera. Nobody knows this, but for Mad Max Fury Road, for all those shots, those storms and stuff were all real. George Miller was running naked side by side with the giant vehicles they constructed, yelling, yeah, that's it, yeah. They had to work really hard to edit his voice out. And if you listen real close, you can still hear him through the boom.
Yeah, that's why you have all those Yeah, that's why you have all those loud engine roars and stuff. It's to cover up him just being too excited about it.
It's important. It's impossible to drown out George Miller's raw excitement for action like that, though.
Yeah, it's wild. He's like 80 something years old and still doing this stuff.
Yeah. Still running fast enough to keep up with the vehicles.
Exactly.
That's probably why he does it naked, for like cuts down the wind resistance.
Yeah, that's true.
Yeah, in an interview, Anya Taylor-Joy commented on, like, do you have to do that naked? And apparently he said, no on the why. No on the why, Sheila. He called every woman on set Sheila. So it got real confusing when he was trying to differentiate between them.
Yeah, especially when there's like two females in the same scene and he's trying to direct them. It's a real pain. He would never call them by their character name or their actor name. They just Sheila.
Sheila. Everyone was Sheila. Man. And then one of the extras was named Sheila, apparently. So she thought he was always talking to her. And every time she would respond, he'd be like, who are you? Get out of here. I don't know who you are.
But yeah, it's a fun old time.
Something about the idea of the opportunity to do the voice of an Australian wild man just triggered my improv senses. I was like, oh, this will be a character. This will be a fun one.
Yeah, anytime I think of like the over-the-top Australian stereotypes and voices and stuff, I always think of Tropic Thunder.
Oh, yeah.
There's the scene where the rapper guy, he's like basically getting in Robert Downey Jr.'s character's face. He's like, oh, did that upset you? Did a dingo eat your baby? And like every time he says something like like with that one, he's like, did a dingo eat your baby? And Robert Downey Jr.'s character is like, you know that's a true story, right? Lady lost her baby that way. You crossing the line right now. Just keeps going. And he's like, oh, I'm sorry, all you got is Crocodile Dundee sort of thing. He like grabs him. He's like, that man's a national treasure. Great movie.
It's been a long time since I've seen it.
Yeah, I've seen clips. Yeah, it's been a while since I've seen the whole thing, but I've seen clips like within the past year. I recently did watch a comedy movie of a filmmaker I really like, and I'd never seen the movie. Because it's almost impossible to find. It's so weird. It's Kevin Smith's Dogma.
Oh, yeah.
That movie, it's so weird how you just cannot find it. Like, it's not on any streaming services. You can't rent it online digitally. Yeah, you can't buy it digitally online. Huh. And all the physical stuff, like DVDs and Blu-rays, are out of print.
Huh.
So if you want to get the DVD, it's like 30, 40 bucks. If you want to get the Blu-ray, it's like $150 because it's people selling it on eBay and stuff. So I don't recommend this with everything, but because the Weinstein company, like they're the ones that own it, Harvey Weinstein owns the movie, because they're such buttholes about it and not doing anything with it, you pretty much have to pirate it.
Yeah.
And I didn't go through any weird websites or anything to get to it. There's some fantastic people on YouTube who have uploaded it on YouTube. So I watched it that way. And I overall thought it was good. I thought it'd be a little bit better. It's very much like at the time, there was a lot of backlash.
Yeah,
like back when they were releasing it, because it deals with like it's Christian comedy kind of yeah, poking at Christianity a little bit. But also a thing is like Kevin Smith is never like denying or crapping on God or anything. Like throughout the whole movie, like God and Jesus are like, yes, they rock. They're a thing, sort of, or they are a thing. He's never like crapping on them or anything. Yeah, he adds like a couple things here and there. Like he adds a poop demon that's made of poop.
Yeah.
But I mean, it's like,
I wonder why Brandon likes this movie.
It's just one scene.
It's a mystery. It's such a mystery.
but there's like some ideas here and there, and like it's I'd say if anything, it's more like not entirely bashing, but very much it's not poking fun, like poking at God or Jesus. It's more poking at the Catholic Church.
Yeah.
And the organization itself. Because Kevin Smith grew up Catholic and stuff, like a lot of like people like grow up Catholic sort of thing. But no, I thought it was like a pretty decent comedy that like, in my opinion, I don't think it's like blasphemous or anything. I think it's like, and they even say at the beginning, like before the movie even starts, there's like those like where like paragraph pops up and you got to read it in black sort of thing. And yeah, it's basically like, we at View Askew Productions want you to know this is all fictional. Like, we're not trying to hurt any feelings or anything like that. Like, it's all a joke. You should realize that. Realize that's all a joke. And also be lenient with us because of it being a joke and all this stuff. And then in parentheses, it's like, that includes you, critics. Be lenient with us. That sort of thing.
Yeah.
But yeah, like I don't know. I understand the fuss, but I also don't understand the fuss.
Yeah. What's with all the fuss?
Yeah, exactly. I think he did
no more fuss.
A decent job. Yeah, no more fuss.
Stop with that fuss.
Just watch the movie.
Just watch the movie.
Don't be stupid. Understand that this is just fiction. Like, this isn't like a man saying, oh yes, this is how angels are, or whatever it may be, sort of thing.
Like, yeah,
it's a story.
Yeah, you over there, quit fussing.
Quit fussing.
Quit fussing. Do I come over there?
Do I gotta put your little fusser? I gotta put out that little fusser of yours.
Yeah. Do I gotta punch out that little fusser of yours? Huh? Punch you right in the fusser. I'll do it. Don't get me started.
There's a lot of funny moments in the movie. There's one part that is probably going to stick with me for a while. Like, there are some Kevin Smith jokes in his movies that stick with me for a long time. There's one towards the very end where, spoiler alert, our main character meets God. And like, God is played by, I'm trying to remember how to pronounce her name. Alanis Morissette. Yeah. And in the movie, like, God is like silent, like doesn't talk. Like, God has like a personification called the voice, which is Alan Rickman's character. Like, anytime God is trying to speak to someone, uses Alan Rickman to talk to them, sort of thing. Because if in the movie, if God spoke, it'd just like kill the person, basically.
Yeah.
But the main character, Bethany, the movie's wrapping up, and she goes up to God, and God's also like kind of like funny in a way, not like super silly, but just like kind of funny. Basically, when asked, why are we here?
Yeah.
God boops the person's nose.
Oh, okay.
Like, God pretends to think about it for like about 5 seconds and then just boops the person's nose. And then Alan Rickman's character like walks by as they're leaving. He's like, didn't I tell you she was funny? It's nice. There's some good moments in the movie. I don't think people have to get up in arms about it. I don't think Christians really need to get up in arms about it.
Put your arms down. Yes. I also watched a comedy movie over the weekend.
Nice. What was it?
My Cousin Vinny.
Oh, I've been wanting to see that. I haven't seen it yet.
It's pretty funny. It's Joe Pesci and Marissa Tomei and Ralph Macchio, but Ralph Macchio doesn't do a lot in it. So the story is basically like the first like 10 minutes of the movie, I want to say, is Ralph Macchio and another guy, I can't remember the actor's name, but people would know him if they saw him. They'd recognize him. But Ralph Macchio and the other guy, they're like two college students. It's an older movie. They're two college students, and they're like from New York. And and I think they're like on their way somewhere for spring break or something, but they're driving through Alabama.
Okay.
And they stop by a little convenience shop on like the side of the road real quick and get some stuff. And then they, you know, get in their car and they drive away. Well, one of them shoplifts a can of tuna. Then the other guy jokes that it's like, oh, you know, like they got like medieval laws down here. You know what the how low the bar is for the death penalty in Alabama, and they, you know, laugh about it. But then like they get pulled over by the cops, and oh, and there's like a scene in between that where like the cops show up at this same convenience store and the clerk has been shot dead in a robbery. So they pull over the two college students and like, you guys are under arrest, and they don't like explain anything. They don't say anything. So like when they're and the two college students think this is over a can of tuna.
Right.
So like they're in there like confessing to everything, basically like, yeah, we did it. You know, and they're like very casual about it because they think they're just being detained for shoplifting a can of tuna. Yeah. And then like they find out like that they're being held for murder. And Ralph Macchio's like, what? So like they call his mom, and they're like, dude, like, is there anyone at all we can get that would like any lawyers in the family? He finds out like there is a lawyer in my family, and then the other guy asks, who is it? And Ralph Macchio says, it's my cousin Vinny.
He said the title.
He said the title. I know. I said roll credits when that happened. I was watching it with my parents and my sister. And as soon as he said that, I blurted out roll credits. But so the thing is, like, that first 10 minutes kind of sets you up to think that Ralph Macchio and his buddy are going to be the like main characters of the movie. And that Joe Pesci's character, Vinny, is going to be kind of like a goofball add-on character. That's really not the case. Vinny is really the main character of the movie.
Okay.
So it, from that point on, it really mostly follows Joe Pesci's character. His fiance, played by Marissa Tomei. Nice. Yeah. I know, I was watching it and my parents were like, this is Miss Marissa Tomei back when she was hot. And I was like, I would argue she's still pretty hot. Say,
when is she not then?
Yeah, when did she stop being hot?
Yeah.
And then my parents were like, yeah, but we mean like young and hot. And I'm like, okay, whatever.
Yeah.
But yeah, so it was a very funny movie. It's one that I learned over the course of it. My parents apparently quote a lot.
Oh, they've seen it a good bit.
Yeah, and I recognized a few of the lines here and there.
Yeah.
But and it's just, it's a funny movie because Vinny is like a very inexperienced lawyer. He tried 6 times to pass the bar. He's never actually taken a case to court. He's mostly a personal injury lawyer. This is his first time trying a murder case. So it's all this. And plus he's like in a different state than where he actually practices.
Yeah,
he practices
in
New York. Now he's in Alabama. And like the judge is super strict. It's very clear that everybody in that town is ready to railroad these two into prison and into the electric chair.
Yeah.
So it's like very much one of those, like all the odds are stacked against them sort of things, but it's a good movie. Very funny. And it, you know, has a very interesting climactic court scene that is equal parts cathartic and funny. Because like the climax, the final court scene, like Vinny is finally not on the back foot.
Right.
Like for the whole movie, Vinny's at a horrible disadvantage. And so like he gets to that final court scene and he finally knows what he's doing. And it's a fun, like comedic character piece to watch, I think.
Okay. I'm gonna have to check it out. Yeah. It was on my watch list like a year or two ago. And I was going to watch it, and then it just never happened. So I'm going to have to put that higher up.
Yeah.
I'll have to check that out.
There's a...
Yeah.
There's a joke that I tell sometimes, because my family, a huge chunk of my family is Italian.
Right.
So I make the joke that, like, if you're Italian and you don't have a cousin Vinny, you are cousin Vinny. Every Italian family's got a cousin Vinny.
Yeah, for my my redneck family, I don't know what the stereotypical thing would be, like, if you don't have a cousin named Cletus,
oh.
Then you're Cletus or something. Yeah, the guy that has the weird stories, but can help you with any jam. Yeah. You're stuck on the side of the road.
What about preserves?
What were we saying? Oh, yes. Yeah, if you're stuck on the side of the road, if your car is stuck in a ditch, if your car is stuck mudding, it really, he mostly just does towing. That's what Cletus mostly does. He's just, he'll pull you out. That's about all, though. But he'll be there. He'll pull your car or truck out of whatever. But
yeah, as they say in the Ninja Sex Party song, Next to You, if your car breaks on the road, I'll grab my crank and pick you up. Do you know what the Ninja Sex Party song Next to You is about?
No.
You should give it a listen. All right, that's one of their classic ones.
Okay.
That one's like I think it was on their first album.
I gotcha. Oh, I just remembered, before we started recording, I got a phone call. And it was an Alabama number, so I didn't think much of it. I know a decent bit of people in Alabama, so I didn't think it was scam or anything like that, or telemarketer. It could have been, but didn't think much of it.
Yeah.
I answer, and it sounded like a woman speaking. It sounded like there were people in the background, or this person was in a public place or something.
Yeah.
And I said hello. I said hello a couple times, and then she said, "Hey, can you hear me?" And I was like, "Yes." And then right after that, like a 2 second pause maybe, then it got into clearly automated woman voice. Really? And it made me realize and think, automation calls are getting more and more real. The person I had thought was a woman the whole time was just the robot.
Huh.
Like, because it's so weird. I've never had, like, when I answer, it sounds like they're in a public place. I heard, like, background noise and stuff.
Yeah.
Like when the woman was trying to talk and stuff, and I said hello a couple times, and the way she said, like, Not only the way she said it, but just saying, like, can you hear me?
Yeah.
Never heard an automation, like, get that close to it. I guess it's one of those things where they programmed it to where if someone says hello twice or more, it puts in the thing of saying, can you hear me? But it just sounded kind of real. And it kind of freaked me out because I thought I was talking to a real person at first.
Yeah, that's really weird.
So I think, yeah, we're going. I mean, like, it's already this, like AI voices and stuff like that. Eventually, Teo is going to get a phone call from me. It won't be my phone number, but he'll get a phone call from me where I'm just saying something like, "Hey, I want you to know, I murdered those people." And then it hangs up. And then Teo and the cops, because Teo, obviously, he's going to tell the cops, why would he not, are going to think that I murdered someone because it sounded exactly like Brandon. And then it's going to spiral down. Then I'm not Italian. I'm going to have to find some guy named Vinny. And since I'm not in the family, he might rip me off or something. So we'll have to see.
To be totally fair, Brandon, that doesn't sound any different than the sorts of forum calls we've had in the past.
True. Yeah. Yes, it's often I confess my horrible life to Teo.
He says, "Oh boo hoo, oh boo hoo hoo, I killed them. I killed them all."
I say it exactly like that as well.
And I say, "Get over it. It happened. Move past it. Don't need to cry over it, baby."
Then it brings new light to me. I'm like, you know what? You're right. Yeah, I feel better. Yeah. Yeah, beep that person. I'm glad I did it. I go about my day.
And the song "Raindrops Keep Falling on My Head" starts playing while you just walk off.
Yes. Teo's my sick and twisted version of confessional.
I'm like a priest.
Yes.
He loses his way, and I'm like, "What's the matter with you?"
So you killed a couple people. So haven't we all?
Haven't we all knocked off a couple guys? Hey. Oh, hey.
Hey, say a couple of Hail Marys and forget about it.
Just forget about it. I'm murdering here.
Whoa, you want to walk into the church building without your contribution?
Hey.
What are you doing? Get out of here.
What's the matter with you?
Whoa, you trying to take the styrofoam wafer?
Styrofoam.
Whoa. Because us Catholics, we don't do with none of that cracker stuff.
Yeah, well,
it's got to be the wafer.
It's got to be the little discs of styrofoam. The little discs of styrofoam that make people in the church question, "Is there a God?"
Whoa, you're not going to let me put the styrofoam disc on your mouth, on your tongue? Whoa, ayo.
Whoa, whoa.
You don't belong here.
Get out of here. We're going to whack you later. We're going to kill you. I'm going to kill you in Minecraft, so that's not a confession. Get out of here before I beat you across the skull. Go on, get out of here before I put on my brass knuckles and I start knocking your teeth down your throat. Get out of here. Get out of here before I staple your butthole shut so you have to hold in your farts till your balls explode. Go on, get out of here. Hey.
Hey, I'm going to throw you in the river. And you ain't going to be walking on it. You're going to be sunk down.
Because I'm going to hold you down with my hands.
I'm going to make sure you die.
I don't have
access. Minecraft.
In Minecraft. So it's not a confession. I don't have easy access to a cement mixer, so I can't do the cement boots thing. I have to hold you down with my hands. Do you have any idea how hard it is to get a cement mixer? I can't do that shit by hand. I can't mix that with my hands. I gotta hold you down. Holding you down in the river until you stop moving is easier than mixing cement with my hands. Oh, hey.
Oh.
I'm gonna shoot you in the face. In Minecraft, that's not a confession. I'm gonna strangle you to death and enjoy it. I'm gonna bash your face in with a hammer.
All right, now let's all bow our heads.
Let's all bow our heads and pray. In the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit, I'm going to handcuff you into a bathtub, fill the bathtub with water, plug a toaster in, and then throw the toaster in. Amen.
Yeah, I really like the, I'm murdering here.
That's a clip. That's an audio clip right there. Oh, goodness.
Yeah, which, like, we're not going to, like, milk it. But those Todd McFarlane things are doing great. I made another clip, and it's...
I noticed. They're doing views. They're doing numbers.
Yeah. This one's now probably going to be the second highest thing on the channel.
Yeah.
Like, the first one was the highest.
Yeah.
But listener, no, we're not milking Todd McFarlane.
No, he wouldn't appreciate it.
He wouldn't appreciate that. Us
milking. What are you doing in my house? Why are you trying to milk me?
Why are you trying to milk me?
Stop. Hang on. I got a question for you. That's like what he does to keep us from milking him. So stop. I got a question for you. Starts inching towards the window. I got a question for you. It's a real simple question. But you got to answer fast. Quickly opens the window, turns back around to us. Before you milk me, here's a question. Is it worth chasing me down the street to milk me? Jumps out the window, runs. I got nipples. Can you milk me?
Yeah, I gotta look back at it. I think I heard recently the old Todd father is going to do some work with Marvel again. Which,
really?
I mean, I know the man can be stubborn in terms of sticking to his word. He stuck a long time to this word, but he said he was never going to like do Marvel stuff again.
Yeah.
But hey, I don't think it's a bad thing. I'm not going to like bash him and be like, oh, but you said 30 or 40 years ago.
Yeah.
Like, no, he stuck to it a long time.
I was going to say, you say that he's stubborn about sticking to his word. How long has he been promising a Spawn reboot movie?
Yeah. Well, at least I'll say with that, like, yeah, he's been promising it for over 2 decades. What I'll say with that is he's stuck with it the whole time.
Oh, yeah, yeah. It's like, with audible air quotes, stuck with it.
I think it's one of those things where, like, I think a couple decades ago, if he truly, truly tried, he could have got it, like, he could have got a producer to finally do it. He has been trying, but yeah, I think he could definitely try harder. But yeah, it's just one of those like development. Oh god, I'm burping.
Oh,
one of those like development hell type of things.
Yeah, development hell. Isn't that the ideal place for
Spawn? Oh yeah, it's the Spawn movie's going to be like extremely meta.
Yeah. I've been in hell for so long. I'm Al Simmons. And I was recently posed the question, would I hold my farts in until my balls explode? Spoiler alert, I got no balls! He just whips out guns and starts shooting. Ah! I'm Spawn.
Yeah, if the Spawn movie started out with like Todd's intro.
Yes! Oh my gosh, it absolutely should.
Yeah.
It absolutely should start with a Todd McFarlane. You got to answer fast. Well,
yeah, if he was like, what would you do if you created a character and that character grossed millions of dollars and you write a script, a great script, and that script gets tossed into limbo, eventually goes into hell. Hi, I'm Todd McFarlane, and that's the story of Spawn. This is what this movie's finally going to be. You're finally going to see this thing that has been in hell. It's going to rise up out of hell, just like our friend Al Simmons. Al Simmons is coming out of hell, just like this movie. Yeah, I want Todd McFarlane to do an intro to the movie. That'd be great. Or even if he didn't, because I know like. I think he has like some deal with Blumhouse or something.
Yeah.
To do it. At the very least, end credits. Or not, doesn't have to be end credits, but like once the movie ends and the credits are rolling. I'd love that. Or you could just do end credits where everyone is left, nobody cares, except those that want to see Todd McFarlane do his intros. Like you can add that into the movie without upsetting some people who are like, the movie was scary and it was good, but that intro was so corny at the beginning.
Yeah, film it on the same cameras that they used to film them for the cartoon, and with the same music.
Yeah. Yeah, everyone's like, oh my gosh, it's in like, it's like 240, like the frame rate, it's 240 when we're now at like 4K visuals.
In a 4:3 aspect ratio.
Yeah. Yeah, eventually that'll come out. That movie will happen. I don't think anyone really has faith in it.
Oh, no.
I think Todd's the only one that still cares or has faith in that movie.
Yeah. Jamie Foxx is still definitely going to be Spawn.
Yeah, he's still going to be Spawn, I'm sure.
And as promised, it's a horror movie, and he's barely going to be in it.
Yeah.
Because that's what people want in the Spawn movie. It's for Spawn to barely be in it. And have that be like one of the things that I'm promising that's supposed to make it cool.
I forgot. I think you're right. Wasn't that one of the things he said?
Yeah, it's one of the things, because he wanted it to be like, you know, one of those horror movies where you barely see the monster so that you like, you can build them up more in your mind. But it's like, we know what Spawn looks like, dude.
Yeah.
Like we know, like, yeah, if you do it well, sure. But like, we're not going to a Spawn movie to watch like 2 hours of a bunch of like mob guys and criminals doing stuff, and then maybe 20 minutes of Spawn beating them up.
Yeah, no. Like he can do that a little bit to a degree where it's essentially like the Robert Pattinson Batman movie, where it was that build up in the beginning and then he emerges from the shadows. You can do that, but Spawn needs to appear within the first 15 minutes. By the end of the 15-minute mark, he better appear.
And the thing is, in the Robert Pattinson, the Batman movie, it was like 2 minutes. 2 minutes of buildup till we see Batman
exactly.
The first time. And then he's in that costume for most of the movie.
Yeah. Yeah, like a number one thing with screenplay writing and screenwriting, like you're the stuff you want to introduce, specifically like how the plot is going to go, needs to be shown with most movies. Now, there are some outliers, some exceptions where it does work not doing this. But for most movies, what this movie is going to be and who our big characters and stuff like that are all need to be within the first 15 minutes.
Pretty much.
We need to have all of that introduced. And then it goes.
Yeah, if you're like 40 minutes into the movie and you're still introducing the important characters, that's too long.
It's too long unless you're doing like a grand trilogy or something.
Yeah, unless it's like an epic movie, like something like Lord of the Rings or something like that.
Yeah. But if it's a one and done thing, it's like no. Get to it. Get to the point. Don't have all this build up for 40 minutes. Because I think that's an issue with like modern day movies, is not entirely saying all of them have the issue of let's do 30 to 45 minutes of build up. That is an issue with some of them. But I think that's part of the issue of like why movies get so freaking long nowadays. Yeah. And really it's a studio thing. The studio wants like to have a bunch of as much time as they can, because they're spending all this money on it. And it's like, well, to make an hour and 30 minute movie compared to this 2 hour and 30 minute movie, like that extra hour didn't cost us a ton more. I don't know, but I
the thing is though, with a shorter movie, you could get more show times, which means more ticket sales.
Oh yeah, that's also what I don't get is of making your movie so long. Like there are exceptions. There are movies where it's like it's this grand epic or whatever it is where it has to be long. Like it needs to be.
Yeah. But must be as long as you can make it. Longer.
Yeah.
Longer
than and I'm not like strictly just poking at Marvel movies. The only reason I'm mentioning Marvel movies right now, or fixing to, is like it's what's in theaters all the time, or what was in theaters all the time.
Well, so also Marvel has actually been slashing run times for their movies lately.
Lately, they have.
In fact, the past year or two, too short, and could have used a couple extra scenes to flesh some things out.
Yeah, like the past year or two.
Yeah.
But there are some movies that have come out like 3-4 years ago where, I don't know, like there can be stuff that can be cut or just rewrite the movie or something, rewrite the script to get the time down and it not be so boring. I'm looking at you, Eternals. Like, yes. I know you have a big cast and stuff. You gotta show us all of them. I get that. You can rewrite that to where it's not dragging till the third act. Like, I don't hate that movie, but it's just, it really is kind of boring up until the third act.
Yeah.
Like, there's interesting things here and there. I'm not going to say, like, there aren't interesting things in the first two acts. Like, I like the Angelina Jolie and that, was it Mad Gilgamesh?
Gilgamesh. But, yeah, like, the whole Mad Weary plot line.
Yeah. I like those elements and stuff. That was interesting. But, yeah, I don't know. What do I know?
Nothing.
What? Exactly.
You're some kind of freaking dumbass.
Yeah. Just a dumb duty head. I don't live in L.A.
Stinky ball sniffer.
Yeah. I don't live in L.A. I'm not given a $250 million budget that is just extremely stupid on whoever's part of budgeting.
Yeah.
But what do I know? Apparently nothing, because that's how movies should be made nowadays. It should be $250 million to make a movie. Yeah. To make the same quality of movie that 5 to 10 years ago, the same quality movie would cost them maybe $80 million at most.
Well, yeah, but that comes down to inflation after a certain point.
Inflation has not gone up that much. It has gone up, right. But it hasn't nearly tripled.
I don't know numbers. And also, if a number is big enough, I stop paying attention to what you're saying, like, specifically.
It's just, like, such a dumb number. Yeah. Like, $250 million. Like, it's so stupid.
It is. That's a lot of money.
Yeah. Because, I mean, like, I'm not...
With $250 million, just to put this into context for some people, because some people don't know that's a huge amount of money. Because, well, like, when numbers get big enough, they become abstract.
Yeah.
But that's so much money that you could give 250 people $1 million from it.
Yeah. Well, let me see.
You could give 25 people $10 million.
Trying to find something. Because I'm trying to look to see if just like really show how much money that is. I'm trying to look up countries with somewhat low GDPs.
Yeah.
There's plenty of countries. I'm just trying to find examples. There's plenty of countries, not plenty, but there's a decent bit of countries where like their GDP ranges around that.
Oof.
Like it's like and it's made to make this movie, which I'm not bashing making a movie. I'm not bashing the hundreds, if not thousands, of people that are involved in making the movie.
Yeah.
But it's just so wild that like a country's GDP is the same amount of making Captain Marvel or something.
Yeah. That's an especially harsh example.
Well, I really want the listener to just get like how stupid we can be with money sometimes.
Yeah. No.
And especially
like if you think about it too much, you just disgust yourself realizing like, oh, like a lot of the world's problems could be solved with the amount of money that gets poured into movies.
Yeah, and I'm not even saying that. I'm not even saying like, oh, all of this should go to there. I'm just trying to show some of the dumb examples of this big money and sometimes being wasted. Now, here's the thing. I get with like most Marvel movies, it's a stupid high budget, but it's almost a guarantee where they make their money back, if not make a profit. And usually it is like a profit. So it's like, okay, yeah, as a business, it makes sense. Even if it's
a disappointing profit, they still make a profit.
Yeah, yeah, exactly. Yeah, it's not what they wanted to make, but it's still a profit. Whereas like there's other cases where it's a huge flop for also how much they spent on the movie. Indiana Jones 5, like, didn't they spend like $300 million on that movie or something?
I don't know. I don't look at movie budget a lot.
I'm trying to remember. Let's see. That's what the box office was. I know they lost nearly $300 million from it in terms of marketing and all that stuff.
Yeah.
It lost nearly $300 million. Yeah, let me see. What the heck's the budget? Why wasn't it showing the budget?
Show me the money.
Oh my goodness. Oh my goodness.
What?
Why does this movie cost this much?
What's the budget?
Okay, so there's a couple different things.
Uh-huh.
But you could kind of meet in the middle on it. Yeah. All right, so some have said it's estimated to be $295 million to make the newest Indiana Jones. Some reports say upwards of $387 million. So you can say it's probably at least $300 million.
Yeah, it's probably more in the 300 to 315 range.
Yeah. But that is just wild that they would, because that, okay. I understand like smart investment stuff, a Marvel movie. Yeah. Like if you're an investor and you're trying to help with budgeting and all that and making a Marvel movie, it makes sense to throw in that kind of money because it's like, hey, we're almost definitely going to make our money back, if not a profit. But something like Indiana Jones 5, why did they think this was a good investment to spend that much? And I'm not bashing the quality of the movie. I haven't seen the movie. I'm not talking about the quality of the movie at all. But simply this movie that a trilogy spawned from back in the 80s and early 90s, very early 90s. And has lied dormant up until Crystal Skull. That came out. That didn't do great in box office. And also, people like panned it. They didn't like it at all. And then, 15 to 20 years later, you say, hey, let's do it again. And also, our lead actor is now like 85 years old.
Yeah.
So let's do it. It's clearly, oh, Johnson said our budget is going to be at least $300 million. Sure. Yeah, I could easily see this making $1 billion. Who the hell thought this? Like, so stupid. Like well, I legit am wondering, like, how stupid are some people in Hollywood? I'm not saying all. There are some smart investments, but this was clearly a dumb investment. Like before the movie came out, I would have said it was a dumb investment.
Some of the bean counters look at it, or some of the executives look at it, and they say, Indy Jones, help made by George. And George made Star Wars, and Star Wars does a lot of money. Even bad Star Wars does a lot of money. So people like Harry Ford as Indy Joan, and we make new Indy Joan. How much money to make? It don't matter. Because we know Indy Joan 5 do a lot of money, we think. So make it.
Yeah. That basically had to be the thinking. Because like clearly they aren't thinking. Because yeah, like Star Wars, like yes, the one thing that ties the two together is George Lucas' involvement. The thing is like this has never been as big as the Star Wars franchise.
Nope. You can hear
never the, has been. Yeah, and also
you can hear the Weekly Planet guys talk about this sometimes, where they'll mention that like Indiana Jones has not maintained the same constant cultural presence that Star Wars did.
Exactly. Yeah, that's the thing, is like Star Wars through like, so you had the main trilogy, and then it didn't lie dormant. You still had toys going out. And then
video games.
Before the Clone Saga, the prequel trilogy comes out. And that's when like everyone's hearing about, because that's when the toys were the biggest, were during like Phantom Menace days and stuff. So it's everywhere. And then after Revenge of the Sith, like you said, it still goes on. There's the Clone Wars. There's all this other stuff, TV shows, video games, all this stuff that still keeps you. Yeah,
novels,
books. Yeah, yeah, we're huge. So you have all this stuff that still keeps people in and still introduces new generations to Star Wars, because it's so big and it's still going. And then when you have Force Awakens, not only do the nerds from the 70s and 80s want to go see it, but everyone wants to go see it because they know about Star Wars, because Star Wars has been present in their life, whether they're watching the shows or whether it's all the commercials they're seeing like on TV. Indiana Jones has never had that. it's fairly dormant up until the Crystal Skull. But Crystal Skull does decent, but also it got panned. And then from Crystal Skull to this, a whole new generation spawns during that time, because that's 15 to 20 years later. And in between that period, what do you have in terms of bringing the new generation in? Oh, we have Lego Indiana Jones 1 and Lego Indiana Jones 2. That's it. Our weakest, in terms of sales wise, our weakest Lego games, that's what we have. It's like, you did not pave the road for this to be successful. Yeah, it's so wild. I feel for anyone that like that worked on the movie and like genuinely put a ton of time and effort into this, and they maybe didn't get the money they were promised. I'm sure that was a factor. But for the big wigs up top that decided to do this, I'm glad they lost a ton of money. But the issue is they probably didn't. So.
Yeah. No.
Yeah. Sorry to go to go down there, but when I saw that budget, that just sickened me.
Yeah.
Yeah. I'm not.
It's an upsetting like budget to look at. It's like, seriously?
Well, it's an upsetting budget to look at for a movie that like doesn't show that budget. Because that's the thing. I'm not going to bash a super high budget if the movie is like great quality and clearly looks like, hey, they used every penny of that budget for the movie.
Yeah.
The case in point, Dune, like the past two Dune movies, specifically Dune 2, I think it was like, oh, it may have been $200 million, maybe a little bit more. You see it though.
Yeah.
Like it's clear, like, okay, they knew how to budget. They had someone who didn't waste money, essentially. Burn money.
Yeah. Yeah. This wasn't a money laundering scheme. This was a...
Yeah, exactly.
This was a real movie.
Which, this is a joke. It's not like Disney would listen to this. This is a joke, but it seems like nearly every modern day Disney movie is that for how high the budget is.
Yeah.
Allegedly. In Minecraft.
In Minecraft.
Yeah. Oh my gosh. Let me see. Oh, so aside from my cousin Benny, my cousin Vinny, what have you been up to the past week?
I've been struggling with school a little bit. Oh, okay. Oh, I read a really good book actually for school though. Okay. It's called My Antonia. It's written by Willa Cather, and I believe it was first published in 1918. It's just a really good book. It's just about like life on the Nebraskan plains in like the late 19th, early 20th century. Most of the main cast are like European immigrant characters. And it's just a really good book. Like, I don't want to talk about it too much. It would be a difficult book to outright spoil because it doesn't really have a plot. It's just like a long sequence of events. Okay. But they're all tied together primarily through the theme that the main character is he's a man named Jim. And the introduction of the book is that a friend of his who grew up in the same town as him was talking to him, and they kept talking about this same girl that they knew growing up named Antonia. And so finally they're like, well, let's like just write some notes or whatever about like what we remember about her and what she makes us think of. And the friend who proposed it just like scrawled a couple notes, and they're like, yeah, whatever. He wrote 5 short books. And again, this is a fictional character, but
right.
But he basically wrote his entire childhood experience well into like his adulthood as well, about this one girl / woman that he's known throughout his life. And it's very good. It's a very touching read. I finished reading it before church on Sunday, so I had to take a shower before like right after. So I was like stifling tears in the shower, like it's a good book. It's very touching. It's 106 years old and holds up remarkably well.
That's awesome.
Yeah, so it's just good. So anybody out there who's never heard of Willa Cather and wants to read what is apparently her magnum opus, My Antonia.
Yeah, that's what I'm seeing online. A lot of people are saying that about it.
Yeah, I had never heard of this book before it was assigned for school reading. And yes. I'm so glad that it was, because it was fantastic.
What class is this for?
20th century literature.
Oh, yeah.
I think 1914 to 1945 is kind of the focus. But yeah.
Teacher, if we're going to go over 20th century literature, why can't you include Watchmen? That was like a classic thing of people, especially in high school, who were into like graphic novels and stuff.
Yeah.
They'd really, and I, for the most part, I'm okay with it for like high school, of like trying to push like, hey, like in high school, sometimes there were cases where you didn't all have a specific book you were assigned to. You had like 10 choices or something. I remember, it wasn't at my school, but I remember a friend of mine saying this happened at his school of someone pushing Watchmen on the list, and Watchmen did get on the list.
Yeah. They actually got Watchmen on the list?
Yeah, they got Watchmen on the list.
Dang. Is that what you ended up picking?
No, it wasn't at my school.
Oh.
If it was at my school, I probably would have picked it. I'm trying to think what the heck I picked. It was probably, maybe it was like Great Expectations or something.
Okay.
Or Oliver Twist, or I don't know. There's a lot of books that we read in high school that I don't remember. There are a few that stuck out to me.
You want to cheat Oliver Twist, just watch the Disney classic Oliver and Company. There you go.
Oh, there we go.
Because that is, because something that that you don't realize as a child, but is so, so clear as an adult, is that just about everything Disney created, like everything Disney did, like as far as their animated films goes, excuse me, nearly all of it, public domain.
Oh, yeah, that's right. Yeah.
Public domain adaptation. I think the only things that weren't public domain when they made the adaptations of them was stuff like, oh, goodness. I don't think Bambi was public domain by the time that Disney made that movie. And I'm fairly certain that The Black Cauldron was not public domain, so that had to be like an officially licensed adaptation.
Oh, okay.
Though I'm not certain of that one either. I'm not certain of either of those, but I'm pretty sure neither of those were public domain. But like, they're pretty much everything else, though, like Disney didn't come up with any of their own ideas.
Yeah.
Like the most creative they ever got was like, make it about animals. That's why you get Oliver Twist as a cat and Hamlet as a lion.
Okay.
Because that's something that I think a lot of people don't notice either, is that the Lion King is Hamlet. It is a Hamlet adaptation.
Yeah.
Slash blatant plagiarism of Kimba the White Lion. But I'm going to be honest with you. I don't know how much water that one holds.
Yeah.
That accusation. It's a cartoon about talking lions. Like, I've not seen Kimba the White Lion, anybody. So, like, don't quote me on this, but I'm pretty sure it's just a case of parallel thought on that front.
All right.
The Lion King is most primarily an adaptation of Hamlet. I mean, he even got like Timon and Pumbaa as Rosencrantz and Guildenstern. So, you know, like it's down to like character roles. It is an adaptation of Hamlet.
Yeah. Yeah. I just thought about it. Like, I actually liked reading in middle school and early high school, but during that time of middle school and early high school, it was mostly like comics and graphic novels. Like elementary school, loved reading in terms of straight up novels or whatever. It wasn't till like the last half of high school where the teacher finally got me back into enjoying regular novels again. And it's the classic, like, I don't know, I guess, like, I'm not trying to say I was, like, edgy, but it was the classic thing of, like, a 2000s kid, how you got them into reading classic literature. It's like, oh, here's Edgar Allan Poe. There's some crazy, twisted stuff in here. And then you as, like, a kid that doesn't read a bunch of novels and stuff, you read that and you're like, holy crap. This guy hundreds of years ago, he wrote some spooky stuff.
Holy crap, and Lois.
There's a lot of people like that.
Holy crap, Lois. Check out this Edgar Allan Poe guy. This is even crazier than the time I read Edgar Allan Poe. Cut away to, holy crap, Lois. Check out this Edgar Allan Poe guy. It's an infinite loop.
Yeah. And then, like, I think a lot of kids can get into reading this way because, like, a lot of media, whether it's TV shows, comics, movies, whatever it may be, are often influenced or heavily inspired by classic literature.
Yeah.
If you can, like, point those out to kids or if they see the connection or are just interested, that can kind of get them into it. Like, I remember reading the short story Ozymandias. The only reason I read it was because of Ozymandias and Watchmen.
Yeah.
Like, I knew that was a guy in Watchmen. So I was like, ooh, I want to read this. And I liked it. It's a interesting little short story, but I don't know. You gotta get those things that like they've heard of, even though it might not entirely tie into the story or whatever.
Yeah.
You can't just drop the, I'm not saying all classic literature is this, but you can't just drop the versions of books that say thou hast or thee, there are all this stuff. Like you have to get the modern day translations because they have those in those type of books, like Scarlet Letter.
Yeah, you need the New Living Translation of Shakespeare.
Yeah, yeah.
Can't go King James Shakespeare.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. Yeah, because my sister, she was assigned to read the Scarlet Letter last year or the year before.
Yeah.
And the teacher said, hey, y'all should read the classic version, but I'll also give you the modernized English version of it to help you along the way. But please read in the classic version. And my sister was reading it. She was like, I cannot do this. I'm just going to read the modernized version. Like, this is so stupid. I can't follow the plot or anything because I don't understand half the words.
Yeah.
Because she gave it to me at one point and was just like, here, read this out loud. And it was a paragraph. And I was reading it out loud. And it there were some these and thous. It wasn't too bad. The last sentence of the paragraph had like, and it's maybe a 7 to 10 word sentence. But within the sentence, it had a thee. It had a thou. It had a has not. Like it was like, whoa. Whoa. In one sentence, it had all these old vernacular terms, all these words. I'm like, you can't do this to people nowadays.
Like, I think I hate your teacher.
Yeah, this is so bad.
Introduce me to them so that I might drown them with my bare hands. I don't have access to a cement mixer. It's more difficult than you think it is to get a hold on one of those.
Yeah, like I understand trying to get them to read like what it sounded like back in the day. You're having trouble enough getting kids to read nowadays. Just if they want to read the modernized version, just let them read the modernized version. Like it's hard enough getting kids to read nowadays.
Yeah, don't do this to children. To literal.
If you do that, they will be turned off from reading for the rest of their life. Maybe eventually they'll pick it back up.
They'll be so turned off from reading. They won't even read street signs. They won't read menus at restaurants. They won't read the subtitles on anime. They won't read the covers of movie boxes. They'll be so turned off from reading. They'll be like, nope, reading hurt me once.
Yeah. They'll be so turned off from reading that you'll create a society where all it is on that menu is a picture of a burger and then the number 1 right next to it.
You'll get a society that waters their crops with Gatorade.
Yes. It's got electrolytes.
It's got electrolytes. I've still never seen that movie.
It's really good. I know it is kind of a cringy thing how many people online will be like, oh, we're in Idiocracy.
Oh,
this is what society's coming to. It's kind of cringy hearing all that, but
yeah.
It's kind of true. But aside from the sadness of that, kind of like it's a very funny movie.
Yeah. I'm sure.
Yeah.
I'm sure.
Yeah, there's the Dax Shepard. I think he's not in a ton of movies. No. I personally would say this might be his best performance.
Okay.
Because he plays the dumbest man on earth, pretty much. And he does such a great job. And like, if you've seen Dax Shepard in anything else, you'd be like, you see any other Dax Shepard performance, then you watch this and it's like, the man has range. I never thought I would say Dax Shepard had range, but seeing this, the man has range.
Hmm.
But yeah, he's just watching a show called ow my balls or ouch my balls, where it's just a guy getting hit in the balls or like falling onto stuff and it hitting his balls and stuff. He's just dying laughing. And there, and while he's watching it, there's just all these like porno ads like around the screen kind of. It's just, yeah. But yeah. I'll briefly get into stuff that's been going on my week. Aside from Furiosa and Dogma, I haven't watched a lot of stuff. I've been trying to stick to writing / getting a schedule of writing more.
Yeah.
It's not super successful, but I need a little discipline, so it's helping some. But yeah, editing, like all the editing Gallows Man number 3, which only 3 pages left of that comic. I'm so glad, I'm loving the comic. I think it's funny. I'm so glad the 3rd issue is finally almost done. So yeah, like there'll probably be a Kickstarter for that in like August or something.
Ooh.
Dismay Avenue number 3, this last story for it has taken a long time, but I'm liking it, and it's, for me and the artist, it's kind of experimental for both of us. This is like the first comic where I've done where it's a complete silent story. Like, yeah. No
dialogue whatsoever.
No dialogue, no noises, no onomatopoeia. It's strictly the visuals telling you the story.
Interesting.
So I'm enjoying that. And it's in black and white to kind of look like a old movie or TV show sort of thing. But yeah, that's going good. We're the last 2 pages of the convention comic. I'm not going to say it by name on here. But the last 2 pages of that first issue should be finished inking by tonight. And then tomorrow or the day after, I'll finally hire a colorist. I have 4 in mind. I'm going to commission each of them to do 1 page and just kind of see what color style works best and hire that one.
Once I'm able to get a subscription to that screenwriting software that I used in my class last term, I should have, if you're still willing to have me, I should have some scripts ready for the second issue.
Yeah, that'd be good. How I have it so far, what I'm going to do is this issue, once it's done in terms of the pencils, inks, the colors, the lettering, once it's done, I'm going to pitch it and try to get some sort of publisher. And the thing I was going to do to entice them is pretty much say, like, at least a 6 issue series. It can be more than that, though. Because I have 6 whole issues completely scripted out, but I want to do like I want to do a thing where like me, how I think this could go on beyond just 6 issues. Like, yes, I have like probably 2 to 4 more issues of stories I could probably come up with, but I'd love to do the 6 issues I have scripted and then like almost like seasons, like if they would like just keep, if it does good and they just want to keep doing the series, almost like seasons. And at that point I would take more of like an editorial role where I would pick up like comic creators or writers in general, and like, because it's already an anthology.
Yeah.
And just like facilitate, like, okay, here are like the second season of this comic essentially, and it's like six issues, and it's each issue has stories from different creators and all that stuff. Like, if that's possible, I'd love for that to be the route. Because I don't want it to just like, I'm not saying it dies, but I don't want it to just like end with the Brant Forreskin story.
Yeah.
Because that's one whole issue. Like, that's like the closing issue for me in terms of the stories I have. But everyone, especially like writers or comic creators, have gone to conventions. They've tabled at conventions, probably.
Everyone's
I would love to just get
experience.
Yeah, yeah, exactly. I would love to just like get all of that into this series and have that be the thing that like continues the series on, instead of it just like stopping at my issue six or whatever.
Yeah.
How do I write that in a cover letter? I'll figure that out.
Yeah, yeah. That'd be difficult to get through in a query letter.
Yeah. But
by the way, I've been learning how to write those in my current class.
Oh, that's good.
Yeah.
That might be something I can learn from you about, because I know almost all the ins and outs of making a comic, but now there's always something you're learning. Now, yeah. The new thing I'm going to have to learn in the next few months is pitching, and specifically by email. I can pitch to someone in person on my book, but in an email, I got to figure out how to get it just right. And not in terms of like pitching to like a YouTuber or someone to review it, but like truly professional, as well. It has the cover letter and all this stuff with it. Like, that's what I got to start learning.
Yeah. So are you thinking of taking it to an editor or an agent?
This specifically, just because it's a comic.
Yeah.
I'm just going to go through submissions through various publishers, and just try to see which one picks it up. If a publisher has like a decent deal per issue, and also pretty much this, if a publisher has a decent deal, but would pick up both this and the food truck comic, I'm probably going to go with them.
Yeah.
If they pick up both of them. But yeah, cause that's another thing, is the food truck comic. That's also going to be a thing I'm going to be pitching. But yeah, like that's what I'm going to be doing for these, is going through submissions of various publishers and trying to get one to pick it up. And if multiple want it, the best deal, I guess.
Yeah.
But, yeah, it's just two pages need inking of that one. That one's a tabletop story, like a tabletop game story.
Oh, okay. It's
trying to
a Warhammer style war game, or like an RPG?
The beginning, like the characters that our main character goes to, they're playing essentially like a Warhammer type game.
Okay.
But then he has to go off and play a simple game. I won't get into too much detail.
Oh, okay.
This isn't spoiling it, but basically they're playing Warhammer and he has to go play like Go Fish, essentially.
Oh. Yeah. Old maid.
But yeah, once that's inked, that'll be good. And then like the food truck story, the first story of that first issue is now completely done in terms of art and everything. So now Juan is now starting on the second story.
Okay.
That's a thing. Like, at the very least, at the end of it all, there will at least be an issue one of both of these series. That's the thing that's great overall. But man, would it be great if I was able to do like with the food truck one. I have 6 issues completely scripted.
Yeah.
Comic script. If I was able to do all 6 scripts, same thing with the convention one. The convention one is even bigger because I had mentioned the idea I had with it. Like, yes, I have my complete 6 issue script thing.
Yeah.
But I know and want it to be bigger than that. It all depends if a publisher sees that sort of thing, but we will see as the future. But yeah, in the meantime, I'm writing the county fair comic I have.
Oh yeah.
I'm slowly finishing up that series. I really like the stories I've written, but I've been so slow at adding more stories to it. I have many ideas for it. I have outlines of stories, but I've just been so slow to it because I just haven't felt it or haven't felt the mood for it, essentially. Like, I have 22 story scripts completely finished for that. I want to have 30 in total. If I had 30 in total, that'll be good. And that'll likely be like 10 issues in total, like once I organize all that. But yeah, so I've been like not really touching that one that much until I'm actually in the mood. But in the meantime, Banana Slug, like, that is taking up a lot of my time, which I'm happy because I when I'm not in the mood for the county fair comic, I jump straight to Banana Slug, which is just random absurdist comedy anthology. And I like it because it's an absurdist comedy anthology like the convention comic or the county fair comic, but Banana Slug doesn't have a setting theme or anything like that with those comics. It's literally just a hodgepodge of comedy and absurdist comedy stories. And for that, like, I write a decent bit for that just because the county fair one, it's hard for me to be in the mood for nowadays.
It's hard to get yourself in the mood.
Yeah.
Gotta listen to music. Yeah.
I just need to go to a county fair. And I think that's what it is. I just need to like engross myself in it. Like, I already have story outlines, but I just need to live in it for a day and then I'll be like, okay, now I'm ready to write that story about the mirror maze. But yeah, maybe if I go to a county fair, I'll be in the mood then. I did write one last week. Like, it had been over a month since I wrote anything for it, but I wrote one that dealt with, I don't want to say the whole plot, but it dealt with those, I don't know if you've ever seen the game where it's like the rubber ducks and like the kiddie pool or whatever.
Yeah.
And with some of those, a lot of times it's like a matching game. Like, you're getting a rubber duck and it has a number or a letter on the bottom of it, and you're trying to find the one that matches it and you get a prize sort of thing. It deals with that. And I really like that story. I'm glad I finally wrote something for this comic in over a month. But yeah, lately I'm just writing the random absurdist stuff of Banana Slug, which then, like, that's what sucks about all this, or maybe it's good. It then branched, like, part of it branched from writing Banana Slug stories to where I wrote 2 stories that dealt with biblical stories.
Yeah.
And those were originally for the Banana Slug comic. But then I started getting more ideas for more comedic scripts dealing with biblical stories. So now I've separated that, and now it's going to be its own anthology series, a comedic biblical anthology series. So yeah, it's good, but it's also bad at how much stuff just branches or comes from another series.
Yeah, it's hard to control that.
Yeah, because I'm thinking about almost all of my comics, I think, have done that in some form or another. Tales from Town City did that from Gallows, man, where I did the little two-page thing in Gallows Man 2, and then I was like, ooh, I want to do more of these. You get Tales from Town City. I was doing Curbsided, and I'm ultimately not going to do this plot line, so I can just get rid of, like, say it out loud. There's going to be a part where they bring the food truck. Like, the whole issue was them having the food truck at a county fair. And you're going to get a story from that. But then as I started thinking about it, I was like, oh no, like, I could do more with this county fair stuff. And then that's where the county fair anthology came from. And then as I'm writing that, I'm like, but I have all these like funny random ideas that you can't really throw into a county fair theme. And it's like, well, banana slug, that's where all of that can go. Then as I'm writing that, it's like, oh, like these biblical stories, but there's so many of them. I don't want like
it become its own theme.
I don't want this like this thing that is supposed to be no theme to now have a little bit of a theme. And I also don't want this story dealing with Solomon to be right after a story of a extremely patriotic guy who is saluting the flag, and his penis is also saluting the flag. So it's like, no, I have to separate the two. So now there's the biblical anthologies series. So yeah. So yeah, there's no telling what's going to branch from the biblical one, but we'll see. But I'm giving stuff to myself that I want to write.
Yeah.
When I get kind of not entirely burnt out, but maybe just like needing a break from something, I can jump to something else that I'm working on. Like how it's kind of been going with the county fair thing, and jump to banana slug or the biblical thing. I'll leave us off on not a crazy serious note or whatever. We'll leave us off on a experience I had this past week. I was going to mention it at the beginning, but I completely forgot about it. So I went to Whataburger last week.
Yeah.
And I like Whataburger. I rarely get to have the Whataburger breakfast.
Yeah.
Because a Whataburger is like 15, 20 minutes away from me. I don't want to go that far. But sometime last week, I was over in that part of town because I was helping my mom, like taking her places and helping her do stuff. And we passed the Whataburger. I was like, ooh, yes, once we're done with all this, that'd be great. I'm going to go get breakfast. I'm going to go get the breakfast burger at Whataburger, which is fantastic. I'm going to get the jalapeno cheddar biscuit, which is great. I'm going to get that. And for an hour of us running errands and stuff, that's all I was thinking about. That reward of a great Whataburger breakfast, specifically the order I had in mind of the breakfast burger, jalapeno cheddar biscuit. We eventually get done with errands. I go to Whataburger. I order, and we're sitting there for a while, like 15, 20 minutes, like your average Whataburger.
Yeah.
I'm okay with that. Eventually, I get the bag, and I start driving off. I'm just thinking, like, as I'm driving off, I'm trying to get on the highway. I'm just like, oh, it's going to be so good. I can't wait. Driving on the highway, we're minutes down the road, and I start digging in the bag, and I see, like, the little hash brown things, like the side order of hash browns. I'm like, oh, okay, I guess they just, like, added this to my order accidentally or because it took so long. That's cool. Added a little bonus. Start snacking on those, then I'm like, all right, time to get to the breakfast burger. And I reach down and I find two biscuit shaped things. I open them up. It's not my order. It is a basic ass sausage biscuit.
Oof.
Just a regular sausage biscuit. And then the other thing was the honey chicken biscuit, which isn't bad. It's not bad, but that's it. That was the order. And I was so frustrated / upset because for over an hour, like a little fat boy I am, I was just salivating and thinking about the breakfast burger and the jalapeno cheddar biscuit. And that is not what I got. So, like, begrudgingly, I was just eating it. Because I was hungry, and we were way past Whataburger now. There's no way I can turn around and go back and change the order or whatever.
Yeah.
I'm just eating it, just like, it's such a basic sausage biscuit. Like, ugh. Just eating it to get full now. Time passed as we're driving, and I started not blaming Whataburger as much. I was less angry with Whataburger at that point. And I was more angry with the name on the receipt.
Oh.
because you have your, you give your name when you do the order and they put it on the receipt. And this guy, Nate, I was and am more upset with Nate than I am Whataburger. Oh. Because Nate, why are you ordering a basic sausage biscuit and a honey chicken biscuit at Whataburger? Like, and here's the thing. It's not a money thing. It's not that at all. Because it total wise is almost identical to the same cost as my order. Nate, if you are out there and somehow listening, why are you doing this to yourself? Why the basic order? I hope that you got my order. I hope you did. And I hope you see and realize what a good Whataburger breakfast order is. And I hope it changed your life. I hope you eating the breakfast burger made you realize, oh my gosh, I've been a piece of shit this whole time. I hope you realize that. And you will now go on the rest of your days ordering a breakfast burger and maybe the jalapeno cheddar biscuit. But I hope it changed you, Nate. I hope it changed the error of your ways, because if you want a sausage biscuit, a basic sausage biscuit, just go to McDonald's. McDonald's has really good regular sausage biscuits. You don't go to Whataburger for a basic sausage biscuit, Nate. Okay? That's it. It bugged me a lot. And I hope Nate has changed. I hope he got my order. Again, this happened last week, and I've been thinking about it since.
Well. Yeah, you know, I've never been quite that positive about getting a wrong order, thinking that, like, I hope the other person got my order and realizes that they've been living a terrible life.
Because my order was good. I'm not trying to sound like I am bragging. That's a good Whataburger order. The jalapeno cheddar biscuit, it's kind of gone down in quality, but the breakfast burger is still really good.
Yeah.
And you compare that to a basic sausage biscuit that is one of the weakest sausage biscuits in all of fast food. And then the honey chicken sam biscuit, it's okay, but you can do better, Nate. And I hope it taught you a lesson. So, yeah.
All right. Well, Nate, you've been called out. Yeah. I guess, beg for forgiveness before Brandon tracks you down and drowns you with his bare hands, because he does not have access to a cement mixer.
Yes.
Those are harder to get your hands on than you might think.
Yes. And really, you're lucky. Oh, Nate, you are lucky. This wasn't a $20 or more order, because I would go after you in court. This is a crime. This is a crime against humanity, Nate, to have an order like this. Oh, and also, I can't believe I forgot this part. So I mentioned the side order, the little hash brown things. That wasn't on his ticket. So that meant the employee also probably felt very bad for this basic order. It was like, this guy, I think he needs this.
This guy sucks.
He got some extra hash browns because an employee also thought, man, this guy's a real piece of shit. We got to fix this. So, hope you enjoyed, Nate. I hope it changed your life, or at least changed your Whataburger ordering habits. But yeah, that's all I've got for the day.
All right, then. I don't know that I have anything else.
Okay. Well, I have been Brandon.
And I've been Teo.
And now we're not. Take care.
Take care.